I am Bogdan Glazov, and I'm a security researcher for IoT at Keysight Technologies. So today I want to tell you a few things about IoT firmware analysis. So let's start. Okay. So, what is firmware? Simply put, is the combination of all the code which runs on the device. Now the firmware consists of three components: bootloader, kernel, and file system. The bootloader and the kernel can be exploited, but we will need some more advanced techniques. So that's why for today we will stick on the file system section. So why bother getting access to the firmware? It's because we can find hard-coded secrets like credentials, API keys, IPs, certificates, URLs, emails, and so on. We can even find vulnerabilities in individual binaries. Also, we can emulate the firmware to replicate the functionality of a real device. So even as a company, you can do a competitive analysis and have the possibility to create a better device than your competitor. Or we can create a malicious firmware and obtaining a weaponized IoT device. Well, the main problem, how can we obtain a firmware? There are a couple of ways. First thing to search is the vendor website. Usually you can find the firmware in the support download section. Then a simple Google search can do the trick and gives us the firmware we need. Also, we can dump it from the device flash chip, but we need to have a little knowledge about hardware and also some proper tools in order to do that. Basically, we need a microcontroller that can communicate with the SPI chips. SPI meaning a serial peripheral interface. Also, we can do reverse engineering on the mobile app and we can find the hard-coded URL from where we can download the firmware. And the last but not the least, the update mechanism. So if the device we target has an over-the-air update mechanism, we can try to capture network packets during the update process and see if we can retrieve the firmware. So a few examples. Here we have the official firmware download page from the TP-Link. We see a TP-Link router model. Here we can see how the almighty Google can help us to find the firmware for the Tado Smart AC controller. Then, these are two of the firmware dumping tools. In the left side, we have one called the Etify badge, and in the right side, we have Shikra. But the first thing we need to pay attention to is the anti-tampering mechanisms. So if they are present on the device, they can detect certain actions like opening the device or its forceful breakage and could make the device unusable. Next, during the process of mobile app reverse engineering, we can find the hard-coded URL from where the firmware can be downloaded. Here you can see a hard-coded URL and also the file called, I don't know if you can see very well, kcaps.bin, which is the firmware for the CAN smart plug. So, before we start the analysis, we can use the top 10 issues for IoT OWASP as guidance. The 2018 is the latest version. Now, let's dig into the analysis process. We have static analysis and dynamic analysis. Simply put, the difference between these two is that the static analysis looks at the firmware while it's not in operation, and the dynamic analysis, and the dynamic analysis refers to an up and running device. So, let's start with static analysis. First, I want to mention that this is a non-inclusive list, so basically here we have only an approach example. Most of the time, the firmware will come compressed, often as zip. First thing, we unzip it and then we can run tools like strings or hexdump. If nothing interesting found, we proceed to extract the file system. The most common file system you can encounter is SquashFS, but apart from that, you can also find CrumFS, JFFS2, or YFFS2, and so on. So, to extract the file system in an automated way, we can use an open source tool called Binwalk. After that, we can navigate it like in any other Linux file system. Then we will look for common issues, also called bad practice, like hard-coded passwords, IPs, keys, and anything like this. But because it's pretty hard to search all over the place, we have another open source tool called FirmWalker, which can help us. We see what it can do in a few seconds. Also, we can reverse engineer the individual binaries, and there we can find some hard-coded secrets also. We can use tools like Hydra, IDA, Hopper, and so on. So, the FirmWalker basically is a bash script which will search the extracted file system. It will look for things like access for shadow file, hashed passwords, certificates, configuration files, scripts, binaries, hard-coded or encrypted credentials, IoT network services, emails, IPs, URLs, email, and you can name it. Well, the last bullet from the static analysis was the reverse engineering of the binaries found on the firmware. So an interesting thing you can find during the static analysis process is related to the device remote management capabilities. So here you can see a pseudocode snippet generated by the reverse engineering tool called Hopper. To simplify it, if an attacker sends the hello DBG string, the telnet service would start and the attacker would have unrestricted access to the device. Basically, this backdoor was created with administrative purposes, but it represents a huge vulnerability for every device with this kind of firmware. Now, let's switch to the dynamic analysis. For this, we need a real IoT device or an emulated firmware which can simulate a running device. So, in order to emulate a device, we need a virtualization tool. For that, we can use Kimu, which is a generic open source machine emulator and virtualizer. So after the device sits up and running, we can use different tools also using common pen tests. We can use Nmap to see the ports and the running services. We can inspect traffic with Wireshark or TCP dump. If the device or the emulated device has a web interface, we can use tools like Burp or Zap. And after we have a complete image of the device and what vulnerabilities it might have, we can even use Metasploit or, I don't know, custom exploits to target them. Also, if we have found credentials or we cracked any credentials in the static analysis process, we can use them for a potential login, or we can Google the model and the version and hope for default credentials. Now, let's see a demo about how can we backdoor a firmware. So, this is the firmware which we will use. Basically, we will use the D-Link firmware router, and then we will use a toolkit from Firmadyne called the Firmware Modkit. It contains the scripts which will extract and build the firmware. From here, we will use the extract firmware.sh, which is a bash script which runs the Binwalk tool and put all the extracted files in a single folder. Of course, we need to give the path to our firmware as parameter. Well, the correct one. This process takes only a few seconds. And now the file system is extracted and placed in the FMK folder. Let's navigate to it. Here, the only directory which is interesting to us, it's rootfs. Basically, there is the file system. Now, we need to think at possible places for our backdoor to be stored and start on boot. So one of the best places is the etc folder. Another folder that takes our attention is the scripts folder. So let's check it out. So it looks like there is a bash script called system.sh. It looks very interesting, so let's see what it contains. Now, please stop a little bit the video. Now you do realize that I oversimplified the process of searching for a place to put our backdoor, because in real life it's not quite that easy. Please. So there are a lot of services and they all seem to start when the device boots up. So let's see if we can add a path to our for our backdoor. As you can see, there are many scripts which are placed in the templates folder, so we will try to do the same. We'll create a path in the templates folder for our backdoor. Basically, our backdoor is called Nothing Bad, a very suggestive name. You will have the chance to see it in a few seconds. Okay, so now we only need to output to redirect the output to the console. Okay, we need to see if we didn't broke anything. And we are good to go. Now, let's check our backdoor. So basically, our backdoor is a shell written in C and compiled as a Linux with MIPS architecture as binary. Basically, the bindshell.c is the C script. As you can see, it's a very simple shell. It talks on port 9999, which we will use later. Okay. So now that you saw the backdoor, we need to actually place it in the folder we gave us path earlier, and this is the templates folder. Okay, let's copy it to the templates folder. Okay, let's navigate to it and see if it's there. And here it is. So now let's build the firmware back. So we will use the same open source toolkit, Firmadyne Modkit. So for this, we will use the build firmware.sh script. We gave the FMK folder as a parameter because it contained the backdoor file system. And we are good to go. So don't mind this error because it will appear every time if the current file size is different than the original one. And in our case, it's bigger because we placed our backdoor there. But the build is done and the image is created. We navigate to the FMK folder and you can see the new firmware.bin image. So now we have only two steps remaining: emulate the firmware and connect to the backdoor. First thing we need to do is to reset the database in order to avoid any conflict, because we may have done previous emulations. We have a reset.py script. We run it. And it's done. Now we can emulate the firmware. We use a script called fat.py script from the same Firmadyne open source toolkit. Basically, this script automates the QEMU virtualizer. We give the new firmware as a path and we are good to go. So the reason I chose to emulate this firmware and not others is because this kind of firmware will not run quite smoothly. So there are some additional configuration steps we need to do. Basically here, there will be a bridge network created. Also an IP will be generated, which will give us the router user interface. The network will not be created properly, so when this setup completes, a network script called run.sh will be generated. There we need to do some modifications. Basically, it takes a few seconds to create the script with all the network configuration, and that script will run after this setup is complete. And of course, after we press enter. Okay, it should be ready. Now we know the script is created. And here, there should have been three sockets, net 0, net 1, and net 2. But unfortunately, we have net 0 twice. We need to delete the net 0 and add a net 2. Okay, it's done. And another modification or change we need to do is to enter that command in the running console. Basically, this command will check if there is a physical interface attached to the virtual bridge interface. If it is, it's deleted and create a new one. You might need to run a couple of times because it not worked from the first one. Okay, what better way to check if there is connection? If not, search John on Google, right? Okay, it's still not working. We might need to paste it again. Check again if we have connection by searching for John. And then let's access the router. Well, now it worked. We have our router up and running. And the last step, let's connect to our backdoor. We will use Netcat, we will use the IP generated by the network configuration, and also the 999 port, which you saw earlier. Now we have access to the device. We can navigate to it. We can even try to see the templates folder where we placed our backdoor earlier. And here it is. Of course, thank you, not found. One thing I didn't mention is that the default credential for this router are user is admin and the password is blank. Very, very secure. Yeah, that was all. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, please.
Thank you, Bogdan. Do we have questions in the audience? Yes, no, yeah, we have questions over there. Let me lose some weight in that direction.
Hello, so...
Thank you for your presentation. I have a somewhat of a question. In the real world, to gain access to the binary of your router, you should physically connect to it and extract the firmware that way, or you can do it just by connecting to the router?
Basically, after you extracted the firmware, you can search it in order to find individual binaries. A binary is like, I don't know if you heard of a BusyBox, which is responsible for all the device function.
Okay, because if you physically connect to the router, to the debug section, you gain root access to it. So you can download, you can get the binaries that way
so
as well.
Basically, you need physical access to the device. If you couldn't retrieve the firmware from the section I mentioned earlier, basically from the vendor website or from the Google or anything like this. Basically, if you, let's say if there is a proprietary firmware, you might need to try to connect physically to the device, but you need to pay you need to pay attention because the anti-tampering mechanism can destroy the device.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you for your presentation.
And we have another question here also.
Okay. Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for the presentation. So, in your experience, what are the things that manufacturers do that would stop you or annoy you from doing all this?
Well, first thing, they want public on their website the firmware, so you won't be able to download it. Next, you won't be able to find the firmware anywhere on Google. They can also create anti-tampering mechanism for the device, so you won't be able to open it because you will break the device and make it completely unusable, so it won't help you to retrieve the firmware. Or they will secure their update mechanism, so you won't be able to retrieve it capturing traffic.
Thank you.
No problem.
Here. So, you mentioned that one way to get the firmware is with over-the-air updates. Isn't there any mechanism to block tampering with the update, like the simple thing that comes now to my mind is just checksum or so to see if the expected update was tampered before reaching the device?
No, basically, if a device has the update mechanism, you only need to retrieve it, and you will modify it after you retrieve it. You won't place it again in order to continue the update. You may have, I don't know, another device, and you can place it there and put back on the sale. But what you said is valid because you can do that thing. And yes, if it's a checksum, or even if the traffic is encrypted, you won't be able to do that.
Also, we have another question over here.
Hello, thank you for the presentation. I'm particularly interested in fuzzing results. I'm curious if you have any fuzzing results for firmwares.
Unfortunately, for this presentation, we don't have any fuzzing results. But if you want, we expect you to our stand at Key site where we can present you how the fuzzer works.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
And another question over here.
Hi. Thank you for the presentation. So my question is, what do you do if the firmware is public on the vendor site, but it's encrypted and signed to prevent these types of attacks?
Well, there are a few mechanisms in order to decrypt it. And you will see surprised to see, basically, an IoT device can also have a mobile application. There are many times when the key to decrypt the device or the traffic or anything that is encrypted, it's hard-coded on the mobile application. So yeah, you can try to decrypt it. Also, there are some scripts already created because many vendors uses only the XOR script, encryption.
So, from my experience on embedded devices, the encryption key is usually in the ROM code. Okay, so it's a bit harder to take the key. And the vendor just published the encrypted firmware. You can use whatever attacks you want to intercept the firmware, but unless you get the key.
Yeah,
right? That's right. For encryption and for signing, the public key is also on the device.
Yeah.
So you don't have access to the private key, it belongs to the vendor. So what's your strategy in this case?
Well, basically, if you don't you won't be able to decrypt the device, basically you will fail the firmware analysis.
Hey, I'm wondering, I saw you at the end, you tried to emulate using QEMU.
Yeah.
What are the main issues you encounter when you try to emulate device? And what kind of other tools have you been using to simulate, to test your exploits?
Well, basically, I used QEMU, and this is the most common issue which you may encounter. Basically, the network won't be created properly. So the QEMU does the next thing. It will try to create a new bridge network and attached an ETH2 interface to it. But before that, it will delete any other previous bridge network which ETH2 attached to it. So that's why you saw the modifications I did earlier. And sorry, you had another question?
Yeah.
Basically, I didn't use any tool because from what I know, QEMU is the best to do that. And also, there are the toolkits from Firmadyne, which basically automates all the things QEMU does. So you won't need to know every command because you only will have a script, and that script will do the trick for you.
Hello. I have another question here. Thank you for sharing your experience with us today. So in a real world scenario where, let's say, the firmware isn't available on the vendor's website, let's say the serial port is disabled, how would you approach extracting the firmware? Let's say it's not available anywhere, so you need to extract it. Is from a hardware perspective, how would you extract it?
Basically, if you have a little luck, you can, of course, buy it from the vendor and try your luck to open it and do firmware extraction using the hardware. But again, you need to pay attention to the anti-tampering mechanism, because if it's a closed circuit, you might encounter such sensors or circuitry or anything like this.
Thank you. Let's move on to this side, because I've noticed some questions, raised hands.
Hey there.
Hello.
What are the most common anti-tampering hardware measures, and are there any known ways to bypass them currently?
Well, you can find different circuitries which will be able to delete the flash memory. And of course, the device will function, but you won't be able to retrieve the firmware. Basically, you need to follow that circuitry. You need to have an architecture of the device in order to know how to avoid them or even how to cut them. But this comes with a lot of experience and a lot of broken devices.
I see. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? This side, yes. Just a second.
Hello.
Hello.
Just a short question regarding getting the firmware URL from the mobile app.
Yeah.
I saw that decompiling it, you get the firmware URL. And can you tell me if in your case or in other cases, did you also get a full binary data of the firmware, or did you get access to it totally, or how? Because on mobile, from my experience, they don't give out the full access to the firmware. Just they just have a client version of it or anything like that.
Yeah, that's right. How that's the right thing you said. Basically, you can find only some binaries, but in this case, which I presented to you, the kcaps.bin was the full firmware for the CanCon smart plug. In time, they managed to solve this vulnerability because they were asked to. But yeah, that was the full firmware.
That's great. Any other questions in the audience? Yes, perfect. Can you please stand up?
Hello, thank you for the presentation. Just wanted to ask from the user perspective, so from the other side, in order to secure and be protected for this kind of attacks, what do you usually recommend, like a basic follow-up principle? A couple of points from your side, security tips. Thank you.
There are two main and pretty easy things you can do. First thing is have a very secure password, a very complex one, because also the password can be cracked. And besides of that, if you have an IoT device, you can create a separate LAN for it in order to run. And also, if you don't use an IoT device, so let's close it. That are the main three things every user can do in order to protect themselves.
Okay, next question.
Right. With IoT devices that you're referring to, I presume these are very basic end-user devices, because
yeah,
when you go to these higher-level solutions, what we have learned to do most of the time is not allow it direct access internet if you have everything internally controlled. So, for example, CCTV, you will see a lot of CCTV directly going to the cloud. If you just circumvent that cloud solution, isn't that good enough prevention for now, at least, until...
Yes, of course, it is. But basically, what our friend here said is that from a user point of view, most of the time we think of smart home devices.
Precisely. Yeah. And that's where the end users are not going to know these things, right?
When yeah,
you have a
yeah.
basic user, they yeah. don't care. They yeah. connect everything to the internet. But as long as... Are the vendors not doing something about it? Because we've had IoT devices for what, 5-7 years now. People, are the vendors not doing something to protect it better?
Well, let's hope they will do. The thing is that at this moment, even the vendors can do, let's say, too much security, because an IoT device, let's say, a smart home device, it's a little one, so you can do many things. But of course, they can restrict access to the shadow file. They can put some strong passwords for admin in case of end user won't change their password. Because I also encounter a case when the admin password in a firmware was 5 characters long. It took 5 seconds to break it. So.
And also, what you just showed us, HTTP to download a file, where is the security? Not even SSL protected.
You will be thrilled to see. I won't give any names, but in the IoT ecosystem, there is the analysis of the mobile applications. So there are a lot of applications, some of them for, let's say, planes, which communicates with the cloud server using HTTP. So there are a lot.
Perfect, thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
And also we have another question over here.
Yeah, so sometimes you need the opposite. You need to know it. Have you found cases where devices also offer a verifiable way to see that the binary is exactly the same one that they say it is?
So sorry, can you...
For supply chain issues... So for supply chain issues, or sometimes you need a verifiable device, have you found one of these devices where in the firmware you can verify that it is actually what the manufacturer said it is? Thank you.
Of course, please, a little bit louder.
All right. So I was asking about the opposite problem. When the manufacturer want to prove that the firmware is exactly what they say it is, right? So have you found such a case?
So when the vendor want to prove that the device is the what they say, right? Well, you can do a thing basically if you have access to the vendor web page, you can retrieve the firmware. Also, if you have the device which the vendor sells to you, you can retrieve also the firmware and compare them and see if they are the same. If there are differences in between those two images, there are some problems.
Okay, another question over here. Let's try to wrap it up.
Hi.
Hello.
Samsung, Apple, and Google just launched an initiative, the matter, about the standard around IoT devices. If you have heard about it, do you think this will make better the security posture of most IoT devices?
Please, can you repeat again?
Yeah, the big companies, they just launched a standard about the IoT devices. It's called Matter. Not sure if you have read about it.
Sorry.
Okay, then never mind.
Okay, guys, thank you so much. Give a big hand of applause for Bogdan.
Thank you.
For providing this handy tutorial.